Hi, we're the Bee Gees, and you're tuned to Good Rockin' Tonight.
And there are Pick to Click. Still to come, Cuttin' Crew in part one of our U2 special. Don't go away. 11 to 5, Cuttin' Crew. Down 1 to 4, Franklin and Michael. Up 5 to 3, U2. Up 4 to 2, Crowded House. And 3 to number 1, Brian Adams. Checking out the international charts, Cuttin' Crew jumped from 5 to 1, Jody Watley climbs 4 to 2, and Crowded House slipped 2 to 3 on the U.S. charts. While in the U.K., Club Nouveau stalls at 3, Judy Boucher climbs 4 to 2, and Madonna moves up from 2 to 1, displacing Ferrier. When I last talked to Nick and Kevin of the Cuttin' Crew, they were enjoying the successes of Died in Your Arms and One for the Mockingbird off the Broadcast album. All the boys find themselves again heading for the top 10 with I've Been in Love Before.
We wanted, with Died in Your Arms, and we nobody knew what it was going to do, but it opened up a sort of quite a broad area for us. I was amazed the amount of people that said, so how are you going to follow up a ballad? And I don't ever see it as a ballad. I mean, it's got a rock beat to it. It's not the hard rock song, but it's a rock song. So we wanted to definitely make sure that Mockingbird stamped the fact that we are a rock band, which we definitely are. And if you come to any of the live shows, it's a much harder edge to the live act. But then I've Been in Love Before is one of those songs that I think is a killer.
Again, like Died in Your Arms, it's a non-love song. It's a song about guarding yourself and checking your reactions and maybe not going for the plunge, you know, and then maybe being a bit weak and going over the edge when you didn't exactly mean to.
What's going to keep Cuttin' Crew around? What's going to keep you?
Friends. I think that's important. I think, you know, all the members in our group are over 23, 24. Not far.
Oh, you're over the hill.
And just that common ground of having done the clubs and had the shitty record deals, if I may say, bad on TV.
I don't think you can say shitty on TV.
It's okay. to have made the mistakes and met all those people that wasted your time for 2 years, we've all been through that, so we're all mates. There's a common ground there. There's a lot of humour in the band. And to be honest, if we really thought we would just make our first album. It didn't cost that much money, and it was to open the door, wasn't it? Mm. Just to say, okay, we'll open the door. A few 100,000 people around the world will notice Cuttin' Crew, then we'll make our second album. By that time, we'll be a band, because we were never a band before. It was just me and Kev and a couple of mates. And to be sitting here talking about platinum albums and gold albums and everything is incredible. So I still think that the best is of Cuttin' Crew is to come, because this is just the first one that just was to open the door. We seem to have kicked a few down. So that's what I think will keep us stick together, that it wasn't planned to happen so quickly, and we've got a lot more ideas. And in the live show especially, there's a certain growth happened, doesn't there?
Yeah, well, thank God, like, everybody is the personality types that they are, because there is really still a good sense of camaraderie, you know, in the band. Sometimes, and you hear it said that too much too fast will splinter people, you know, like sort of driving them apart. I think it's driven us together. And then everybody's handled it.
It's a good job it works, because you've just got to live on a bus together for 3 months.
Yeah.
Smelly socks and all.
We hope to see you again.
Thank you, Stuart. It's great meeting you again.
Best of luck. Nice to see you again.
It's nice to be back in Canada. I really mean that.
Mm. Hi, Mom.
Well, I don't know if you realize it or not, but it has been about 3 years since we last heard from Crowded House. The album was Temple of Low Man. They are back with Woodface and one extra member. And via satellite in Toronto, we talk with Nick and Neil at Crowded House. Welcome back to Good Rockin' Tonight.
It's good to be back on Good Rockin' Tonight.
You know, it's been about 3 years since the release of Temple of Low Man. What were you guys doing in that time?
Well, we did a fairly substantial tour of Canada in between times, actually. Canada was one of the few places in the world that we toured properly with that record. We then took a break in order for me to go away and write some songs and produce a baby.
And, congratulations.
Thank you. And sort of generally gather the energy and momentum up so that we could tour the world as we had done Canada with this record with the right amount of enthusiasm. So we started recording at the beginning of last year. We intended to have the record out late last year, but then what we didn't expect to happen was Tim and I to go and write 15 songs and for Tim to join the band, at which point we kept recording, and that took us through to the end of last year.
What brought Tim back?
These songs. Well, he moved back to Melbourne, and so it facilitated us being able to write together. And having surprised ourselves that we could, after a few months it became obvious that the best way to get those songs done and to get a great Crowded House album was to combine the two projects, make life easy on ourselves, and that was really it. It was a creative decision based on a very real bunch of songs that we wanted to do.
And Tim and your brother not been together, you know, since Split Ends. Neil, what was it like getting back together with Tim again?
Well, writing was a revelation. We had never done it in Split Ends, which is surprising, I know, but we had 2.5 weeks and we were working 3 or 4 hours a day, and every day we were literally going on and thinking, we're going to write a song today, or maybe two. And we'd go in and just get really loose and jam with each other and throw harmonies about, and songs just fell out of the sky, and we finished a few things off that were lying around. But it was just a great willingness to do it. We were reveling in each other's voices and singing together after a long layoff. So,
can we stay with Tim for just a second? Nick, what did he bring to Crowded House?
Yeah, well, look, Tim bought, an increased... No, sorry, Nick. Oh, sorry, mate. Go on.
What did he bring? He brought new life to Neil Finn, basically. Neil had been pining for his older brother for many years, and finally Tim coming back to Melbourne. He'd been living in London, actually, and he moved back to Melbourne and gave me somebody to actually go out with in the band, finally, because these two... chaps always go back to the hotel room after gigs, but Tim likes to kick on a bit.
So he brought back the party atmosphere then to the band.
He does. He brings the party atmosphere and the right metaphor and adjective for the right time. He's a genius with metaphor, I feel.
You'll be touring, of course, Where Will Crowded House Be Conquering? And Neil, actually, let me put this one to you, being a father and all. How are you going to be able to mix the duties between touring and being a father? There's so much involved in both of them.
Well, we find that touring and producing children is you know,
mutually
usually worked pretty well in the past. we keep cropping, you know, finding family members in the strangest places. It's a funny thing. But actually, we're going to be travelling almost everywhere. Certainly most of Canada will be covered. Vancouver very early on, in fact, early September. And I'll probably be bringing my family with me at this stage. Look forward to that.
Are we going to go to Nova Scotia this time, though, Neil?
Well,
I've never been there. I want to go there.
Well, look, well, I know there's a couple of opportunities for one of us to go to do interviews, Nick, so off you go, mate.
So this means we'll have an opportunity to talk face-to-face when you get to Vancouver, then. I'm looking forward to that.
We hope so, yeah, although it might blow it. Well, at the moment, we think you're a pretty okay guy.
But we've heard that you're really ugly.
Oh, boy, you know. No, we're looking
God
forward
bless
to that.
You,
we're
Steve.
All joking aside, Steve. We can't wait to get to Vancouver. It's a good city. You live in a good city.
Since U2 formed in Dublin in 1978, the rise to success has been nothing short of spectacular. Their first concert with a crowd of 9 people was at London's Hope and Anchor in 1979. Now, a short 2 years later, they find themselves playing sellout audiences the world over, a trend that has continued through 6 albums, including their latest, The Joshua Tree. This little baby was number one for 9 weeks, produced 2 number one North American singles, and has the distinction of being the fastest selling album in Canadian history. Now closing in on diamond status. Tonight, you two talk about it in the first part of a 2-part interview recorded at the Alma Combo in Toronto. Larry Mullen Jr., Adam Clayton, The Edge.
It has been a wild year, though. You know, a really wild year. And at the start of the year, we really didn't know how things were going to turn out for us. In fact, I tried to stop the release of the Joshua Tree myself. I rang our manager and just said, you know, I really don't think this thing will sell even more than 3 copies. I think we've made a big mistake. But it had already gone to the pressing plant. I mean, went out and to see it, you know, being played on the radio in a way that U2 records haven't been before, even though they've been played in this country before, in a lot of countries we weren't getting much radio play. That's been something to see, and it's been a great year.
In a way, is it kind of scary?
No, not scary. No. A lot of, it's been good fun, actually, having a number one record.
Yeah, we never really wanted to be a cult group. That's just, though we were for many years, I think, probably the biggest cult group around. This is, we're now achieving a level of success we always aimed to achieve. So it's been, I suppose, a culmination of a lot of hard work.
The U2 Bullet the Blue Sky from the latest release, The Joshua Tree. The band's going to be doing a video shoot in downtown Los Angeles.
We would have to go on what's called a TAC alert to get this problem solved. We're not going to do that. You're drawing people in here from Orange County and all over the goddamn place. We're shutting the location down. There is no vote. It happens now.
Well, we had a very smart guy producing it, a guy called Michael Hamlin, and he was delaying the guy. It was incredible, though. It was a beautiful Americanism in a way, because the radio's gestation were genuinely saying, you know, I mean, we have those people coming in, there's 300,000 coming in. There were 300,000 like that. You know, it was unbelievable. And then the police officer, you know, we got people coming in from Orange County and all over the goddamn place. It was amusing. It was a beautiful sort of rock and roll soap opera.
Just lousy actors. That's the problem. That's all we can do is be ourselves. But it's fair to say that we didn't intend the police to play such a big part in that video. It's just
policemen make much better actors than pop star things. Because it's all part of it, isn't it? You know, all those guys, they're only always about my height. So, you know, they're always, you know, they love it. I mean, that guy walked around in the boots. I was in Dublin, actually, driving in my own car. I don't even know if I told you this. And I was driving up by the docks, the Docklands in Dublin, and this car pulled up, police car just pulled up right beside me. And I was just putting on the safety belt at the time, and it's illegal not to wear safety belts, and I was just putting on. And the Garda, we call them Gardaí, police. Garda just said, oh, geez, Bono, no, you don't need to be that scared of us, you know, putting on your safety belt. And I said, well, actually, you know, I didn't see you there. And he said, listen, tell us, that video you did there on the... he says, the Polis. They call each other Polis. I think it's slang. He said, the Polis now, that fella now, was he? I think it was a bike man. Was he the fella with the boots? And I was just going and I realized he wanted to be in the video. He wanted to be in the video. I think if you can't make it as a footballer or as a rock and roll star, the next best thing's the police. Yeah. The trappings of rock and roll starting is, we're just checking them out at the moment. I have on my dark sunglasses. I'm just trying them out today. You know, there's a few other things like that. I just punched one of the security men down there. It felt quite good. I'm just getting into it, really, with the trappings. And now, I suppose I should order a bottle of Jack Daniels and drink it all in front of you.
The real question was actually about Daniel Lanois and your connection with him, the Canadian producer. How did you two get connected up with him?
Well, when we got in touch with Brian Eno, the idea of engineers and stuff came up, and Brian described as an engineering producer that he'd worked with a lot and said that he felt he'd bring a lot to the project, which in fact he did, because he's got a vast kind of history of music playing in and around Canada. He started as a musician and then built his own studio from that, and then gradually got into record production. And now, I mean, he's a full-blown record producer, and he's worked with a lot of people in the last couple of years, and has got very good work out of them.
That's the press story. The real truth is we met him in a pool hall.